monitored by Cucumber Nagios. This is Mike Adolfs from Xing. One last notice before we start. We'd like to have your feedback forms about the conference so we can make the conference even better next year. If you haven't found your own in the conference documents, you will get one at the counter. So, have fun.
Good morning, everyone. and welcome to my talk, obviously. I'm glad you made it all through the tremendous party yesterday night. And I thought I would see more people over at the Mod Gearman talk. And I'm pretty happy that you are all here. I'm also pretty nervous. I'm mostly feeling like Markus Lanz before his Wetten, dass venue. And but you're a much better audience than the usual or the casual Wetten, dass viewer. I hope so. All right. I've been to quite a few conferences this year, and I have something to say. So speak up if something's on your mind. So if I'm too quiet or too loud, if I'm blocking the view, for example, if I make false assumptions, that especially is an advice going out to Michael Medlin in the back. And yeah, to get started, we'll just start with a short cucumber test, I'd say. Given my proposal was accepted, when I'm giving the talk, then I should introduce myself. As you can see, there are three keywords, given, when, and then. Given is the precondition, when is the condition, and then is somewhat like the expected result. And in order to pass the test, I'm just going, well, to introduce myself. So, as I said, my name is Mike. I'm a professional salesman. I'm interested in infrastructure as code, in all terms of automation, and I'm also interested in provisioning systems. Besides my day-to-day job, I'm contributing to Chef, which sounds more than it seems, because I'm mostly finding bug reports, writing new cookbooks, and only did small commits to the code base, to the Chef core. And I'm a freelancing author for Linux New Media AG, which is basically, which I mentioned because I really have to start writing articles again. So I haven't done this for the last year. I'm currently working for Zing.com in Hamburg, and this will change from December on, because then I'll be working for a small company in the Bay Area. So I'll be working in two Bay Areas, in the Lübeck Bay Area and the Bay Area. And that also means that I'm commuting about, instead of commuting 120 kilometers five days a week, I'll be commuting 9,000 kilometers every few weeks. So I'm pretty excited. All right, this is what Nagios thinks about my introduction. Okay, introduction, beer clock. But what exactly is behavior-driven infrastructure about, you'd say now, right? And in order to explain to you what behavior-driven infrastructure is, I'm going to tell you a short story. Imagine there's a new development team forming up in your organization, and you've already provisioned their new set of servers. It's really important that those guys start immediately. It's a very important piece of software, and they need to get started right away. So all that's left to do is to distribute their public keys on those servers. That's no problem. You've done this before many, many times, so you're used to it. So you finally roll out those keys and leave the office afterwards. It's quite late in the afternoon. And to call it a day, you stop by at your favorite brewery. You're about to enjoy the first nip of beer when suddenly the relaxed atmosphere gets disturbed by an angry email of your fellow developers. So because despite all your experience, for some reason the team is unable to access those systems. And therefore, they're unable to start working on this very important piece of software. So your recreational visit, well, it's a bit dark, but doesn't matter, he's working in the dark. Your recreational visit to the brewery just turns into 1.5 hours overtime working from home, fixing or working around VPN issues and fixing the actual invalid keys. So why did this? That's pretty easy. Because that's why. You check for the wrong stuff, or your checks are way too easy. This check SSH only checks whether SSH answers on port 22, but there's no guarantee that those keys have been rolled out, and yeah, it's just a low-level check. To get an idea on how to fix this, we'd best look at the principles of the software development world. So, testing code became mandatory within the last years. So, for example, test-driven development is a term, yeah, and really, really many developers breathe tests and code. So, test-driven development basically includes two types of tests, unit tests and integration tests. And don't try to get an idea of what this code does. It's just a cheap example from that SSH, a Ruby library. But it should show you that a unit test usually covers a certain part of an application. So it's a function or some small part of an application. And that's what unit tests are about. Integration tests, on the other hand, cover a whole stack or certain parts of your application. In this example, it's log in and run some stuff. So an integration test would be to log in via SSH, run LSOth, uptime, run a custom script, and validate its output. That's basically an integration test. TDD is not only about unit and integration tests, but also about a certain aspect of some kind of workflow. And this workflow is somehow called something like red-green refactor. And what that means is you basically start writing a test, which turns red. So there's no piece of software which could turn this test green. That's where you start. The next step is to implement the actual code to get this test to pass. And as a third step, you refactor the whole thing. So sometimes you have to implement code pretty fast, and refactoring is the principle of not changing a code's behavior, but making its implementation a bit easier to read, or making it more expandable, for example. So that's basically it. And the key benefits of this TDD workflow is it makes applications more stable, because almost every aspect of your application gets tested. And it can lead to more modularized code, so it's easier for further developers to extend it. And developers tend to be more productive. All right, back to our unit test example. This code is messy. This is really hard to read, not only because of the slides, but also because of the content. And that's one of the reasons, or one of the main reasons, why people invented a successor, somehow something like a successor, called behavioral-driven development, BDD. And BDD is mainly about collaboration between developers and non-developers. So this, what you can see here, is an acceptance test, and it describes a situation in a human readable form. and the logic to get the test to pass is separated. So a non-developer is able to define a test, and to the developer is then able to define the logic behind it. The workflow for BDLD is basically the same. In this slide, it's exactly the same. You write the test, you turn it green, and you refactor the code if necessary. There are quite a couple of BDLD frameworks on the market. I mentioned two of them, which is RSpec and Cucumber. And RSpec is basically quite Ruby on Rails centric, so it's not of interest for us. But Cucumber definitely is. So to summarize Cucumber in a few words, tests are written in a readable form in plain text. The logic to get tests to work are separated in two parts. Cucumber supports over 40 languages at the moment, so you're also able to not to only write in English or in German, but also in Uzbek, in Finnish, and whatever else, traditional Chinese. And there are a couple of implementations for Ruby, for Java, for .NET, and for example, for Flex as well. Coming back to our SSH example, and before we get back to that, I really have to say, don't try to get all aspects of the code from the next slides, because you won't accomplish. So rather hear me talking and get a glimpse of what I'm saying about certain aspects. This is a feature definition, one of the two parts of Cucumber, of a Cucumber test. And this part clearly defines somewhat like a story. As a user of fooforge.com, I need to log in remotely. And the corresponding scenario, basic login, describes how this SSH connect should work. So given I have no public key set, then I can SSH to fooforge.com with the following credentials. Username Mike, password Fubar, and this won't work. So don't try it out. As said, you could also write this in Finnish. Yeah, that's one of the 40 languages which are supported. Is there someone from Finland around here? Oh, great. Otherwise, I'd have to say that all complaints go to the Google Translate team. So, despite I have a... Pardon? Yeah, that's why I'm telling you and reading the stuff. All right, this is the second part of Cucumber, a step definition. This is the actual implementation in the back, which the developer takes care of. And it says, given I have no public key set, do, and then some pseudocode. And you can see that it begins with a keyword, like the one we've seen at the beginning of the presentation, given when and then. And those sentences are matched by some regex foo. And you can basically do whatever you like with that. Thanks for turning off the lights. Running those tests in the software development world is basically done by using something like Rake, for example. That's the manual way. And software development is also about automatic tests. So, for example, continuous integration tools like Jenkins trigger those builds all the time when someone commits new stuff to the repository. But, well, I actually never seen a system administration team using Jenkins for firing infrastructure tests at their infrastructure. So that's something that's missing. And that's why a smart guy did the math. So he just figured up cucumber plus Nagios, leading to cucumber Nagios. So he basically tried to combine the test-driven world with the monitoring one. This guy is called Lindsay Homewood. He's from Australia, and he's getting paid to do open source monitoring development all day long. You may follow him on Twitter, on GitHub, and he also blogs under a cryptic URL, which you'll be able to click on when you look up his Twitter or GitHub account. Now, well, back to the command line, I'd say. So what cucumber Nagios does is it takes your cucumber tests and turns them into a Nagios plugin. So you can basically take the SSH access feature we've just defined, and you get, Nagios plugin output, common Nagios plugin output back. And this is basically what behavior-driven infrastructure is about, because with that toolset, you can almost check anything from not only a user perspective, but also on the command line. There are a couple of features. Cucumber Nagios enables to interact with servers via NetSSH. It makes use of WebRed and the mechanized library in the back for tests via HTTP. So you can, for example, access a website, look up whether a certain image has been loaded, or you can log in on a website automatically and trigger a search for something. And that's what can be evaluated by the plugin. Cucumber Nagios has also a generator on board for two types, projects and features. All those cucumber features I've just shown you are collected into projects. So for example, a project would be a new application in your organization. And within the project, all those tests for testing the start page or testing search parts of your site are located under there. Creating a project, and that's how it looks like. You take the generator, cucumber Nagios gen, you say project, and then the project's name. And what it does is it generates a file system, or a new directory, a new namespace for your project. And the project is also initialized as a Git repository. If you don't want that, just get rid of the .git repository directory inside. Next step would be to generate a corresponding feature. So in this example, we are generating a feature for the start page of foodforge.com. That's my portfolio, my blog. And you can see that there are two types of files that gets generated. The start page feature, which actually contains the human readable form of the test definition, and the start page steps, which includes all the steps necessary for the tests. Intelligent defaults are applied by the generator when you're firing it up. So in this particular example, you just have to, you don't have to change anything. So the feature for foodforge.com describes it should be up, that's what we expect. And the scenario visiting homepage says when I go to http fuba or foodforge.com, then the request should succeed. If that doesn't succeed, cucumber Nagios would turn red. Running it or executing this feature shows the start page is available. No worries, no problems here. To get more verbose output while developing features, you're able to extend or its output via --pretty. So that basically prints out the feature definition and gives you a good overview about what gets executed by Cucumber Nagios. This is an example for when things go wrong. In this example, we checked for foo-forge.con, which is obviously not available. And it prints out the backtrace from the Ruby library that foo-forge.com is not resolvable. So, and this especially helps you when things go wrong in your monitoring and when you want to get to the bottom of the problem. So this is the way you can ensure that you really know where the problem is. Cucumber Nagios comes with some predefined steps. So you don't have to reinvent the wheel from one project to another. For example, steps for AMQP. If you need to test a AMQP-based messaging system, you're able to do that. Querying DNS servers is also enabled by default. Testing via HTTP as well. Testing via SSH and executing almost anything on those servers is also possible. And another interesting feature is the feature of benchmarking, because you're able to run benchmarks with Cucumber Nagios on certain aspects of your website. And this is a benchmark example. As you can see, the feature for foo-forge.com is called to provide the best performance. Foo-forge.com must be responsive. And in the scenario benchmark start page, we just define that the start page needs to respond within 2 seconds. So given I am benchmarking, when I go to http://foo-forge.com, then the elapsed time should be less than 2 seconds. As you can see in the below, one scenario, one passed, 3 steps passed, so it obviously responded within 2 seconds. Now, what happens when I reduce the time to 1 second? This happens. And I obviously had bad network performance in the room yesterday evening. And it shows you that the time we've expected is 1 second, and it got 1.36 seconds, and therefore this test fails. So, and in your monitoring environment, this would also be a critical, so you would get a notice. What's also possible is that you define whole integration tests with Cucumber Nagios. So here we define a feature called Zing Logged In Search, and the story to the feature is, as a user of Zing.com, I want to search for someone. And the scenario is basic search. Given I have the username Mike and the password FUBAR, when I log into Zing.com, then I can click on the search icon and look up Markus Lanz. So if that fails at some stage, for example, at the login stage, you'll be noticed that exactly this step failed and that anything else under it or following it would fail as well. All right. Let's get back to the principles of BDD once more, behavior-driven development. One of its key features I've mentioned is that you're able to collaborate with your fellow developers or product guys or QA people. And that's something Cucumber Nagios encourages you to do. So imagine you have the following team roles. The product owner on the one hand, the QA guy in your team, the developer, and the mighty sysadmin. So this is your team. The product owner in your team describes or defines the story. The user needs to log in at some place. The QA guy defines the story and writes the feature definitions. So as a user, I want to log in somewhere. Given I have the following public keys, then I should be able to log into those systems. The developer takes care of those steps I've just shown you, defining what the actual feature definition does. And the sysadmin puts it into its Nagios configuration. That's basically it. And this is pretty useful, especially at Zing, because you can collaborate with developers, and they tend to, to get more of an idea of what monitoring is about and what's important. So, yeah, I just show you some benefits of this kind of workflow. Monitoring, as I said, is a or will become a company-wide topic, because almost everybody is in the process of enabling monitoring for their certain application, and implementing checks gets easier because as a system administrator, you don't need to know the internal aspects of the tests, and you are able to read the feature definitions like you would read a book. Yeah, so that gets pretty easy. And this leads to a more fault-tolerant infrastructure after all. So your code gets or will have less bugs. Your monitoring is a bit more extended. So this would lead to a better experience to the user. There are of course some drawbacks. A ramp-up phase is probably needed, so not everyone will learn those principles easily. And you also have to train people in your team to define those testing principles and so on. Dependencies for operations grow, so you have to talk to more people to get more people in the know. That's could be a problem for small teams. Software-wise, currently Ruby 187 works best, and we all know this is the legacy branch of Ruby. There needs to be some work to get it up and running flawlessly on Ruby 1.9. And development could be a bit more active. Lindsay is pretty occupied. He has kids at home. He's working on Flapjack, small side project, or which became his main project. And yeah, it could definitely need a bit of attention. So I'm planning to do something about it from January on, because then I won't be commuting on a day-to-day scale. And I hope I can contribute something meaningful to Cucumber Nagios then. Installation or contribution. The gem is available via gem install Cucumber Nagios. The sources are available on GitHub. And if you're interested in contributing, feel free to browse the issue tracker. I think there are about 20 issues at the moment. In case you would like to know more, cucs.info is the official Cucumber page. So you can read up all this feature and steps definition stuff on cucs.info. And the Pragmatic Programmers also released a pretty handy book called the Cucumber Book. So I've enjoyed reading it a lot. And that's about it. I think I've raced through the presentation. Any questions? Yes. Well, the question was whether this makes sense if you don't have an in-house development. I'd say yes, when you have a good standing with your contractor. It takes a little more time or a little more effort, the ramp-up phase, for defining how those tests should be written will definitely increase. But in general, I'd say it's a good way to ensure that you have application tests in your open source monitoring infrastructure. Don't you think so? Okay. Any more questions?
How is the syntax actually composed? It looks like natural language, but how do you learn the rules? Which sort of syntax is allowed, and which components trigger these check routines?
It's basically the step definitions take those sentences from those feature definitions via regex, and you have a few keywords like given, when, and then, which defines some sort of state or precondition or condition. But that's mainly it. So writing those tests in a human language is pretty straightforward. So basically, you're able, you can accomplish almost anything with those three keywords.
So this means some of the words actually are simply ignored by the regex. It's only that the text looks nicer.
You could do that. Mm-hmm. But in general, you match whole sentences or mm-hmm. parts of a feature definition. Thank you. No more questions?
Everything's stunned. So.
All right.
No more questions?
So. Then thanks for the
Thank you, Mark.
Audience. You may follow me on Twitter or GitHub. I'll be around 20 minutes, 30 minutes from now on. And feel free to come and ask further questions if you want. And also, please give me feedback. Thanks.